Sir, shall I start, sir? Good morning, all of you. Myself, Dr. K. Somasekhar Reddy, working as Associate Professor and Head Department of Pharmacology, Raghavendra Institute of Pharmaceutical Education Research, Autonomous, Anantapuram. My heartfelt thanks to Government of Andhra Pradesh, JNTU Anantapur, JNTU Kakinada and RIPER GPAT cell, which is leading under Dr. S. Nagarjuna. I would like to suggest you stay home, stay safe, and you can utilize these days for preparation of GPAT. I wish you all the best. This is the fourth day and the last day of for online classes of human anatomy and physiology. In first day, I explained the cell junctions, transport mechanisms. In second day, I started with the digestive system, followed by cardiovascular system. In third day, continuation of the cardiovascular system and the starting of the reproductive system. Yesterday, up to primary organs in case of male reproductive system, I explained. Today, I would like to continue with the accessory organs of the male reproductive system, followed by female reproductive system. From these two systems, you may get one or two questions in case of GPAT. Yesterday, I explained that the previous questions which came in case of GPAT and other competitive exams. Once I would like to review the male reproductive system primary organs, so that external organs are penis and scrotum. This scrotum can consist of internally testes, hello. Sir. Yes, sir. Share your screen, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry for interruption. I would love to start with the accessory glands of the male reproductive system. So the first I would like to discuss seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles, these are the glands posterior to the urinary bladder. Each has a short duct that joins with the duct's difference at the ampulla to form an ejaculatory duct, which then empties into the urethra. So it is a gland posterior to the urinary bladder. Each has a short duct that joins with the duct's deferens at the ampulla to form an ejaculatory duct, which then empties into the urethra. So the fluid is viscous and contains fructose, comma prostaglandins and proteins. So the fluid which is secreted from the seminal vesicles, that fluid is viscous and contains fructose, prostaglandins and proteins. Coming to prostate glands, these are a few dense structure about the size of a walnut that is located just inferior to the urinary bladder. So prostate glands are a few dense structure about the size of a walnut that is located just inferior to the urinary bladder. So this encircles the urethra. Prostate glands encircles the urethra as it leaves the urinary bladder. So there are numerous short ducts from the prostate gland empty into the prostatic urethra. The secretions of the prostate are thin, milky colored and alkaline. So the secretions of the prostate are thin, milky colored and alkaline. They function to enhance the motility of the sperm. So the function of the prostaglandins is to enhance the motility of the sperm. Coming to bulbourethral glands, which are also called as Cowper's glands. So these are small, about the size of pea, and located near the base of the penis. So a short duct from each enters the proximal end of the phenyl urethra. So bulbourethral glands, small, about the size of pea, and located near the base of the penis. A short duct from each enters the proximal end of the phenyl urethra. In response to sexual stimulation, the bulbourethral glands secrete an alkaline mucus like fluid. So in response to sexual stimulation, this bulbourethral gland secrete an alkaline mucus like fluid. Coming to seminal fluid, which is also called as semen. Here that is very important. A slightly alkaline mixture of sperm cells and secretions from the accessory glands. Secretions from the seminal vesicles make up about 60% of the volume of the semen. So in case of semen, 60% of the secretion from the seminal vesicles. So secretions from the seminal vesicles make up about 60% of the volume of the semen. With most of the remainder coming from the prostate gland. The sperm and secretions. From the bulbourethral gland contribute only a small volume. So the volume of semen in a single ejaculation may vary from 1.5 to 6 ml. There are between 50 to 150 million spermatocytes per milliliter of semen. So there are about 50 to 150 million spermatocytes. 50 to 150 million spermatocytes per milliliter of the semen. Sperm counts below 10 to 20 million. So for milliliter, that normal value is 50 to 150 million. If sperm count below 10 to 20 million, if sperm count below 10 to 20 million per milliliter, usually present fertility problems. If the sperm count is below 10 to 20 million, that leads to the fertility problems. Coming to very important, the hormones of the male reproductive system. So the hormones of the male reproductive system, follicle stimulating hormone stimulates spermatogenesis. Follicle stimulating hormone stimulates the spermatogenesis. Spermatogenesis is nothing but production of the spermatocytes or production of the simply sperm. Production of the sperm. So follicle stimulating hormone stimulates spermatogenesis. Coming to that, interstitial cell stimulating hormone stimulates the production of the testosterone. Stimulates the production of the testosterone. Generally, that testosterone, that is interstitial cell stimulating hormone. So interstitial cells are Leydige cells that are stimulated by the, that name itself, interstitial cell stimulating hormone stimulates the production of testosterone. Testosterone stimulates the development of male secondary sex characteristics and spermatogenesis. Testosterone stimulates the development of male secondary sex characteristics and spermatogenesis. So this testosterone stimulates the development of male secondary sex characteristics and spermatogenesis. Coming to sperm. So the function of the sperm is to move and carry genetic information to the egg. To move and carry genetic information to the egg. So the function of the sperm is to move and carry genetic information to the egg. So it moves and carries the genetic information towards to the egg. So coming to the structure of sperm, it has head, midpiece and tail. It has the head, midpiece and tail. So the head is the large head. It is the region of the sperm. It is the region of the sperm that contains DNA. The region of the sperm which contains the DNA is head. A tip of the head is covered by an acrosome. The tip of the head is covered by an acrosome. The tip of the head. The tip of the head is covered by an acrosome which contains enzymes that can help the sperm penetrate the female gamete. So the head of the sperm can consist of acrosome which contains enzymes that help the sperm penetrate the female gamete. So which part of the sperm can consist of enzymes which are helping in the penetration of the sperm into the female gamete? Nothing but acrosome. Which part of the sperm is consists of enzymes which are helping the penetration of the sperm into the female gamete? Nothing but acrosome. Coming to midpiece, the narrow middle part of the cell. The narrow middle part of the cell that contains mitochondria. Very important. The narrow middle part of the cell that contains mitochondria. Reason here, numerous availability of the mitochondria is supply of the energy. Supply of the energy. So these mitochondrions are present in case of midpiece of the sperm. Mitochondrions are present in case of midpiece of the sperm. So the narrow middle part of the cell. That contains mitochondria. In which portion of the sperm mitochondria are present? Midpiece. What is the function of the mitochondria in case of sperm? So they can supply the energy to the sperm. Coming to tail, the wave-like motion of the flagellum propels the sperm forward. So because of the presence of tail, the wave-like motion of the flagellum. This tail can have the wave-like motion of the flagellum that propels the sperm forward. So finally, sperm consists of head, midpiece, tail. So head has the, that is chromosome, that is DNA. The tip of the head is covered by an acrosome which consists of enzymes that help the sperm penetrate the female gamete. Coming to midpiece, the narrow middle part of the cell that contains mitochondria, which are supply the energy. Coming to tactile. The wave-like motion of the flagellum propels the sperm forward. We can see the in diagram, so that sperm can have the head. Head is covered by acrosome, and midpiece. Midpiece can have the mitochondria and flagellum, that is tail. Flagellum, nothing, that is tail. You can see acrosome, nucleus, centrioles, mitochondrial spiral, and microtubules. So this is the structure of the sperm. Coming to spermatogenesis. So spermatogenesis, genesis means production. Production of the sperm or formation of the sperm cells. Spermatogenesis is the formation of sperm cells. It takes place in the seminiferous tubules. So the spermatogenesis will take place in case of seminiferous tubules, which are located in case of testes. So the interspersed within the tubules are large cells, which are the sustentacular cells, also called as Sertoli cells. Very important. Sertoli cells, which support and nourish the other cells. The Sertoli cells support and nourish the other cells. Very important. Which cells can support and nourish the cells in case of male reproductive system? Nothing but Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells support and nourish the other cells. Generally, spermatogenesis, in case of early in embryonic development, that means once the determination of the sex is over during fetus development, that is depending upon the fertilization of the which ovum is taking place with which type of spermatozoan. So that means males can have the XY chromosome, whereas females can have the XX chromosomes. So that means always females can have the can produce the X ovum only, in every month. The females produces the X containing ovum only. But the spermatocytes which are coming from the males, maybe they have the X chromosome or maybe they have the Y chromosome. If X chromosome containing sperm is fertilized with X ovum, XX, that is a female. If Y containing chromosome of the spermatocyte is fertilized with X containing ovum, there is a XY, that is male. So once the determination is over, there is a starting of the embryonic development. So early in embryonic development, the primordial germ cells, enter the testes. Primordial germ cells enter the testes and differentiate into spermatogonia. So during early embryonic development, the primordial germ cells enter the testes and differentiate into spermatogonia. So spermatogonia are diploid cells, each with 46 chromosomes. So the spermatogonia are the 2N, nothing but diploid cells, each with 46 chromosomes, nothing but 23 pairs, located around the periphery of the seminiferous tubules. So spermatogonia are diploid cells, each with 46 chromosomes, nothing but 23 pairs, located around the periphery of the seminiferous tubules. At puberty, once the boy came into the puberty, hormones stimulate these seminiferous tubules to begin dividing by mitosis. So seminiferous tubules, what have spermatogonia? Spermatogonia nature is diploid. How many chromosomes are there? 23 pairs or 46 chromosomes. So at puberty, hormones stimulate these cells to begin dividing by mitosis. So some remain at the periphery as spermatogonia. Others become primary spermatocytes. So primary spermatocyte nature is 2N because they are produced by mitosis. Primary spermatocytes like spermatogonia or diploid have 46 chromosomes. So these primary spermatocytes also can have the 46 chromosomes. So spermatogonia undergoes the divisions. The division is mitotic division, produced the primary spermatocytes. So primary spermatocytes are produced at puberty. Primary spermatocytes are produced at puberty. Spermatogonia are present in early embryonic development. So primary spermatocytes are produced from spermatogonia at puberty stage. So that means a primary spermatocyte can have the 46 chromosomes. That is 46XY. That 46XY undergoes the meiosis. That leads to the 23X and 23Y. So this 23X undergoes the meiosis 2. Meiosis 2 is equal to the mitochondria. Converted into the 23X and 23X. So 23X present in case of in one spermatocyte, 23Y present in case of another spermatocyte. So 23X present in one spermatocyte, 23Y are present in case of another spermatocyte. Like that, this 23X containing chromosome or 23X containing chromosome, if maybe undergoes the fertilization with the 23X containing ovum, there is a formation of the zygote again with 46XY. So primary spermatocytes have 46XY chromosomes. This primary spermatocytes undergoes the divisions, produces the 23X containing chromosomes and 23Y containing chromosomes. 23X containing chromosomes and 23Y containing chromosomes. Right? So ultimately, either 23X containing chromosome or 23Y containing chromosome of spermatocytes undergoes the fertilization with ovum. So that is the briefing of the accessory glands of the male reproductive system. So the major gonads in the male reproductive system are testes, the interstitial cells or Leydig cells secrete that hormone, that seminiferous tubules majorly secrete the sperm. The sperm may be consists of the either 23X containing chromosome or may be consists of the 23Y containing chromosome. So development of 23X containing chromosome or 23Y containing chromosome by the process of the spermatogenesis. So now we have the spermatocyte, maybe with 23X containing chromosome or maybe with 23Y containing chromosome. So spermatocytes are ready. Coming to female reproductive system. So the female reproductive system is designed to carry out the several functions. So female reproductive system gonads are ovaries. Ovaries produces the ovum. So what are the major functions or several functions of female reproductive system? Female reproductive system is designed to carry out several functions. So that is 4 is the normal pH of the vagina. Forty weeks is the normal gestation period. 400 oocytes released between menarche and menopause. Means menarche means ability to produce the ovums. So from that to menopause, unable to undergo the menstruation. That is called as menopause. So there is a 400 oocytes released between menarche and menopause. During this period, there is a releasing of the 400 oocytes and 400,000 oocytes present at puberty. So during embryonic development, the girl can have the 400,000 oocytes at puberty. So 28 days in a normal menstrual cycle, which may be changed from one girl to another girl. coming to oogenesis, the name itself, genesis means production. So the development of the egg, ovum, in the ovary. So development of egg, ovum in the ovary is called as oogenesis. So development of egg or ovum in the ovary is called as oogenesis. Coming to oogonia. So generally oogonia in case of male reproductive system is spermatogonia. That gonia means present early embryonic development, either in case of boy or in case of girl. So during fetal growth, the oogonia 2N, these are also naturally 2N, divided into and form the primary oocytes. Primary oocytes. Primary oocytes nature is diploid. Primary oocytes nature is diploid. At puberty, they will form secondary oocytes which are N. Secondary oocytes which are N. And later X, that is X also can have the N chromosomes. The N chromosomes means only either 23X. 23X. Only in case of female reproductive system, both ovums can have the 23X and 23X. 23X and 23X. In there, these granulogial cells of female reproductive system nourish the developing egg cells. Nourish the developing egg cells. They nourish the developing egg cells. Coming to functions of female reproductive system. So, functions of female reproductive system produce sex hormones. That sex hormones are estrogen, progesterone. So, the sex hormones are estrogen, progesterone. Produce egg, that is ova. They can receive the spermatozoa. Support and protect developing embryo. Support and protect developing embryo. They give the birth to new baby. Yes. Give birth to new baby. Lactation, the production of breast milk, which provides complete nourishment of the baby in its early life. So here, the sex hormones are estrogen and progesterone. They can produce the ova and they can receive the spermatozoa, support and protect the developing embryo, support and protect the developing embryo, finally give birth to new baby. Lactation, the production of breast milk, which provides complete nourishment for the baby in its early life. Coming to female external genitalia. Female external genitalia simply is called as vulva. Female external genitalia simply it is called as vulva. Vulva is the term given to the female external genitalia. Vulva is the term given to the female external genitalia. The vulva includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, urethral opening, vaginal opening, perineum. So the parts of the external genitalia of female reproductive system is termed as vulva. Vulva includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, urethral opening, vaginal opening, perineum. Coming to first one, mons pubis, the triangular mound of fatty tissue. It is the triangular mound of fatty tissue that covers the pubic bone. Bone type is pubic bone. That pubic bone is covered by the fatty tissue. That is triangular mound fatty tissue is called as mons pubis. That's why the name originated from name of the bone, that is pubic bone. It protects the pubic symphysis. It has the fatty tissue. During adolescence, sex hormones trigger the growth of pubic hair on the mons pubis. So during adolescence, the sex hormones of female reproductive system trigger the growth of the pubic hair on the mons pubis. Coming to labia majora, also called as greater lips. Labia majora, also called as greater lips, are the part around the vagina. Around the vagina, the major lips are greater lips. Nothing but labia majora. These labia majora containing two glands, Bartholin's glands, which helps the lubrication during sexual intercourse. So this labia majora, nothing but greater helps. These are part around the vagina. containing two glands. The two glands are called as Bartholin glands. Which glands lubricate during sexual intercourse? Bartholin glands. They can sir. It's okay, sir. Shall I proceed, sir? Hello, sir. So female external genitalia is also termed as vulva. Female external genitalia is also termed as vulva. So vulva can includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, urethral opening, vaginal opening, perineum. So the vulva includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, urethral opening, vaginal opening, perineum. Coming to mons pubis, it is the triangular mound of fatty tissue that covers the pubic bone. It is the triangular mound of fatty tissue that covers the pubic bone. It protects the pubic symphysis. Whereas in case of during adolescence, sex hormones triggers the growth of the pubic hair on the mons pubis. So mons pubis name is originated because from pubic bone. That pubic bone is surrounded with fatty tissue, nothing but mons pubis. It protects adolescent sex hormones. During adolescence, that sex hormones trigger the growth of pubic hair on the mons pubis. Coming to labia majora. Majora means greater. Labia containing two glands. This labia majora can consist of two glands. The two glands are called as Bartholin glands. which helps lubrication during intercourse. So these Bartholin glands can secrete the lubricant fluid, which can help during intercourse. So location of Bartholin glands, labia majora. How many Bartholin glands are present? Two Bartholin glands. What is the purpose of Bartholin glands? They can secrete the lubricant fluid, which can helpful in case of sexual intercourse. Coming to labia minora. Minora means less. Labia means lips. So lesser lips are the thin hairless ridges present at the entrance of vagina. So these are the thin hairless ridges at the entrance of the vagina, which joins behind and in front. In front they split to enclose the clitoris. So the clitoris is a small P-shaped structure, very important, which is equal to the penis of male reproductive system. It plays an important part in sexual arousement in females. So the clitoris is a small P-shaped structure. It plays an important part in sexual excitement in females. So it is a small penis-like structure. It is highly sensitive organ. So clitoris is a highly sensitive organ composed of nerves, blood vessels, and erectile tissue. It is made up of a shaft and glands. So this clitoris is made up of a shaft and glands. Coming to urethral orifice or external urinary opening. So there is an output of the urine. Through which orifice there is output of the urine in case of female. That is called as urethral orifice or external urinary opening. Through this opening there is output of the urine in case of females. So it is present below the clitoris and upper wall of the vagina. below the clitoris there is a urethral opening or urethral orifice. It is on above the vagina and above the vagina and is the passage for the urine. Passage for the urine. So very clear location of urethral orifice below the clitoris and above the wall of the vagina and above the wall of the vagina. Below the clitoris and above the wall of the vagina. It is the passage for the urine. Coming to opening of the vagina. Opening of the vagina is separate from the urinary opening. It is separate from the urinary opening. So, vaginal opening present below the urethral opening. Below the urethral opening. Vaginal opening is present below the urethral opening. Where there is a receiving of the spermatocytes during sexual intercourse. Right? Opening of the vagina is separate from the urinary opening and located below the urethral opening. Below the urethral opening. Whereas in case of male reproductive system, here you have to very casually listen. Not listen very carefully. In case of males, through same urethral orifice, there is a passage of urine and also a passage of the sperm. Passage of urine and also passage of sperm. Both will be the same orifice, that is called as urethral orifice. In case of male reproductive system. In male reproductive system, only one orifice, that is urethral orifice, which can involved in passage of urine and also involved in passage of the sperm. Whereas in case of females, urethral orifice is different, vaginal opening is different. Urethral orifice is for passage of urine, which is present below the clitoris and above the wall of the vagina. Below the clitoris and above the wall of the vagina. Whereas vaginal opening present below the urethral orifice. Below the urethral orifice, which is separated from the urinary opening. Coming to the hymen. The hymen is a thin crescentic fold of tissue which partially covers the opening of the vagina. The hymen is a thin crescentic fold. Crescentic fold of tissue which partially covers the opening of the vagina. So hymen partially covers the opening of the vagina. Hymen partially covers the opening of the vagina. It is a thin crescentic fold of tissue. It is a thin crescentic fold of tissue. Coming to perineum. Very important. Peri means covering. Perineum. So the muscle and tissue located between the vaginal opening and anal canal. The muscle which is present are the muscle and tissue which is located between the vaginal opening and anal canal. So between the vaginal opening and anal canal there is a tissue or muscle that is called as perineum. So it supports and surrounds the lower parts of the urinary and digestive tracts. It supports and surrounds the lower parts of the urinary and digestive tracts. The perineum contains an abundance of nerve endings that make it sensitive to touch. So the perineum contains an abundance of nerve endings which make sensitive to touch. Which make sensitive to touch. So it supports and surrounds the lower parts of the urinary and digestive tracts. Second one, it consists of an abundant nerve endings which can make sensitive to touch. You can observe the parts of the female reproductive system. That is external parts, which is termed as vulva. Vulva consists of man's pubis. The pubis term is derived from, it surrounds the pubic bone. And you can observe the clitoris, which is equal to the penis of the male reproductive system. Male reproductive system. And you can observe the urethra, which is the passage of urine. And you can observe the vaginal opening, which can receive the spermatocyte and send the spermatocytes towards to the uterus through cervix. You can observe the perineum. Perineum is the gap between vaginal opening and anal canal. Vaginal opening and anal canal. You can observe labia majora, which are also called as greater lips, which can have the Bartholin glands. Bartholin glands, which can secrete the lubricant during sexual intercourse. You can observe the labia minora. Labia minora, that is lesser lips, which is present. Which is present in case of vagina. Labia majora around the vagina. You can observe the hymen, which is partially covering the vaginal opening. Which can partially covering the vaginal opening. coming to very important female internal genitalia. Female internal genitalia. So the female internal genitalia, the internal genitalia consists of the vagina, uterus, fallopian tubes, ovaries. The internal genitalia consists of the vagina, uterus, fallopian tubes, ovaries. Coming to one by one, very important. Vagina. Vagina is the canal for birth. Vagina is the canal for birth. That's why it is called as birth canal. It is a tube-like muscular but elastic organ. It is a tube-like muscular but elastic organ. About 4 to 5 inches long in adult women. The pH at vagina is, in first starting slide I told, 4. That is acidic. It is the passageway for sperm to the egg and for menstrual bleeding. So vagina is the passageway for sperm to the egg. So towards to the movement of the sperm is required to the egg. Egg nothing but ovum. Sperm want to reach the egg. That is passageway for sperm is vagina. And for menstrual bleeding. Menstrual bleeding also through vaginal orifice. Or vaginal opening. So vagina is the birth canal. It is a tube-like muscular but elastic organ about 4 to 5 inches long in an adult woman. pH of the vaginal is 4, that is acidic. It is the passageway for sperm to the egg and for menstrual bleeding. Coming to uterus. So the uterus is a thick-walled muscular pear-shaped organ. Located in the middle of the pelvis. Behind the bladder. And in front of the rectum. The uterus is anchored in position by several ligaments. With the help of the several ligaments, it can be anchored in their position. So it is located in the middle of the pelvis. Pelvic cavity, pelvic region, behind the bladder and in front of the rectum. So the uterus is anchored in position by several ligaments. The uterus consists of the cervix and the main body, that is called as corpus. So you can come. Cervix is the lower part of the uterus. Yes, we will see in case of diagram in next slide, maybe. The cervix is the lower part of the uterus, which protrudes into the upper part of the vagina. It can be seen during a pelvic examination. We may observe it in case of pelvic examination. Like the vagina, the cervix is lined with a mucous membrane, but the mucous membrane of the cervix is smooth. So it will be observed in upper part of the vagina and lower part of the uterus. Lower part of the uterus is called as cervix. So the cervix is lined with a mucous membrane, but the mucous membrane of the cervix is smooth. Sperm can enter and menstrual blood can exit the uterus. Through a channel in the cervix. Cervix can have the cervical canal. Through cervical canal, there is an entry of the sperm and exit of the menstrual fluid. There is a dramatic growth of the uterus during pregnancy. Yes, we can observe dramatic development of uterus during pregnancy. Simply once listen, cervix is the lower part of the uterus, which protrudes into the upper part of the vagina. Can be seen during pelvic examination. Like the vagina, the cervix is lined with mucous membrane, but the mucous membrane of the cervix is smooth. So sperm can enter and menstrual blood can exit the uterus. through a channel in the cervix is called a cervical canal. There is a dramatic growth of the uterus during pregnancy. There is a dramatic growth of the uterus during pregnancy, occurring by a process of both muscle cell hyperplasia and production of new muscle cells from the resident stem cells. So that growth of the uterus because of the occurring of the both muscle cell hyperplasia. Hyperplasia. Hypertrophy means increase in size without undergoing the cell divisions. Hyperplasia means development of the organ, increase in size of the organ by undergoing the cell divisions. That is called as hyperplasia. You can see the difference. Which process is helpful for the increasing of the size of the uterus, or which process involved in the growth of the uterus during pregnancy? That is hyperplasia. So both, that is muscle cell hyperplasia and production of new muscle cells from the resident stem cells, helpful for the growth of the uterus during pregnancy. So there is a dramatic growth of the uterus during pregnancy because of the occurring of the hyperplasia and production of new cells. The cervical canal, which allows spermatosis and exit menstrual blood, the cervical canal is usually narrow. During labor, the canal widens. Normally, cervical canal is usually narrow, but during labor, the canal widens to let the baby through. The cervix is usually a good barrier against bacteria. Functions I am telling. The cervix is usually a good barrier against bacteria, except the egg is released by the ovaries. Normally, cervix is a good barrier against bacteria, except around the time an egg is released by the ovaries. So releasing of egg by the ovaries is called as ovulation, and also during menstrual period and or during labor. So remember, all these are by God's grace, we have all these things. That's why we are here. Against bacteria, except around the time is an egg is released by the ovaries. Releasing of egg by the ovaries is called as ovulation during the menstrual period or during labor. Coming to functions of uterus, the main function of the uterus is to sustain a developing fetus. So the main function of the uterus is to sustain a developing fetus. It prepares for this possibility for each month. So every month uterus prepared for the possibility of the development of the fetus if ovum undergoes the fertilization with spermatozoa. So it is always prepared for the possibility for each month. At termination of pregnancy, it expels the uterine contents. So the main function of the uterus is to sustain a developing fetus. It prepares for this possibility for each month. At termination of pregnancy, it expels its uterine contents. You can observe very carefully parts of the uterus. So lower part of the uterus is cervical canal, which is present above the vagina. You can see vagina, above vagina cervical canal. And there is a broad ligament. So there is a body. So in case of the above cervical canal, it has the layers. That are layers of the uterus are, you can observe perimetrium. Perim means the middle layer, that is myometrium, which have the muscles, uterine muscles. That myometrium can have the uterine muscles. And that is endometrium. Endometrium is involved in implantation of embryo, or where there is a development of the fetus. That is endometrium. And you can see the ovaries. There are two ovaries. Ovaries are bind with the uterus with the help of the ovarian ligaments. So ligament can place the position of the uterus, can place the position of the uterus. And there is a two arm shaped structures are called as fimbriae. The fimbriae can catch the ovum from ovaries. So fimbriae are nearby the ovaries. Ovaries releases the ovum. The released ovum captured by the fimbriae. Captured by the fimbriae. Very important. Above the fimbriae there is a infundibulum. Above the fimbriae there is a infundibulum. And after that there is ampulla. And there is isthmus. So ampulla and isthmus that are parts of the fallopian tube. So fallopian tubes can have the nearby the ovaries there is a fimbriae. Above the fimbriae there is a infundibulum. After there is a ampulla. And then after there is a isthmus. So these are the parts of the fallopian tube where there is a fertilization of the ovum with spermatozoa will take place called as fallopian tubes or uterine tubes. Fallopian tubes are uterine tubes. That is called as fundus of uterus. Fundus of uterus at right side and left side have the fallopian tubes. So parts of the fallopian tubes are fimbriae, infundibulum, ampulla, isthmus. Okay. So this ovaries releases the ovum. The released ovum captured by the fimbriae. Through fimbriae there is a movement of the ovum. When it finds the spermatocyte, In fallopian tube, it undergoes the fertilization with spermatocyte, lead to the development of the embryo. You can see there is an entry of the spermatocytes from vaginal canal towards the cervix and towards to the fundus of the uterus and then to fallopian tubes. Coming to layers of uterus. So that layers of uterus are endometrium. Endo means inner lining. Next myometrium. Myo means muscle. Next perimetrium. Peri means outer. Coming to endometrium is the inner lining of uterus. Endometrium is the inner lining of uterus. It nourishes the developing embryo built up each month for pregnancy. You prepare for each month for pregnancy. If pregnancy not occur, shed during menstruation. That means it is a inner lining of uterus. Nourishes developing embryo built up each month for pregnancy. If not, shed during menstruation. Coming to myometrium. Myometrium is the muscular. The name itself, myo means muscle. Muscular. Supports fetus, contracts at birth, very important. Which layer of the uterus undergoes the contractions during labor or at birth? The layer is myometrium. The reason, myometrium, myo means muscle. Muscles only have the nature of the contraction. So uterine contractions at which layer of the uterus? Myometrium. So muscular supports fetus, contracts at birth and to shed the endometrium during menstruation. If pregnancy will not occur, there is a shedding of the endometrium during menstruation. Coming to perimetrium, the perimetrium is a serous membrane or outer membrane. The perimetrium is a serous membrane or outer membrane that lines the outside of the uterus. So outside of the uterus is perimetrium, which is a serous membrane or which is a outer coat of the uterus or outer layer. So the perimetrium is a serous membrane that lines the outside of the uterus. So endometrium plays the major role and myometrium also plays the major role. Myometrium have the muscles that undergoes the contraction during labor. Endometrium, it can prepare for the each month, that is for pregnancy. That is development of embryo. Development of embryo takes place. Endometrium. Development of embryo will take place. Which layer of the uterus? Endometrium. And observe. that endometrium help is involved in development of the placenta, endometrial lining of the uterus. If there is a chance of the pregnancy, that means already there is a development of zygote. That zygote need to undergo the millions of the cell divisions. The zygote want to undergo the millions of the cell divisions. Upon millions of the cell divisions, there is a formation of the fetus. There is a formation of the fetus. So the fetus requires the continuous supply of the nutrients. Continuous supply of the nutrients. So fetus can receive the continuous, that is, nutrients from the placenta. From the placenta. Placenta is linked with the fetus. Okay. So the endometrium of the uterus. Endometrium of the uterus. You can say placenta. Endometrium of the uterus. Developed the placenta to supply the nutrients to the fetus. To supply the nutrients to the fetus. Placenta priva, complete. You can see how. Placenta, the complete. Second one is, you can see, cervix. So, when there is a labor, there is coming of first head of the baby, followed by the legs. This is the movement of the labor. Coming to fallopian tubes, which are also called as oviducts. Fallopian tubes, which are also called as oviducts, stretch from the uterus to the ovaries. Stretch, that is, you know, fallopian tubes have the finger-like projections, which are called as fimbriae. The fimbriae catch the ovum, which is coming from the ovaries. So stretch from the uterus to the towards to the ovaries and measure up centimeter in length. So these fallopian tubes measure 8 to 13 centimeter in length. The ends of the fallopian tubes lying next to the ovaries. The ends of the fallopian tubes lying next to the ovaries feather into ends called fimbria. So the last part of the that fallopian tubes are called as fimbria. So, millions of tiny hair-like cilia lying in the fimbria. The fimbrias can have the millions of tiny hair-like cilia that lie in the fimbria and interior of the fallopian tubes. So, hair-like cilia are present which part of the fallopian tube? Fimbria. In which part of the fallopian tube there is a presence of the hair-like cilia that are in case of fimbria. And interior of the fallopian tubes. The cilia beat in waves hundreds of times. A second catching the egg. So the cilia beat in waves hundreds of times. A second catching the egg at ovulation and moving it through the tube to the uterine cavity. So, because of presence of cilia, the cilias can beat in waves hundreds of times. A second catching of the egg at ovulation and moving it through the tube to the uterine cavity. Fertilization typically occurs in the fallopian tube. Place of the fertilization, fallopian tube. Place of the development of placenta, endometrium of the uterus. Development of embryo place, endometrium of the uterus. Place of our fertilization, fallopian tube. Which part of the fallopian tubes can catch the eggs? Fimbria. By the help of hair-like cilia, these fimbrias can catch the ovum or egg towards to it. Then it travels to the other part of the fallopian tubes and enter into the uterus. If they undergoes the fertilization with the spermatocyte, they forms the embryo. So fertilization, you can read. You can see this is the ovary. So first point, release of egg from ovary, and it can be taking by the fimbria, last part of the fallopian tube. egg reaches midpoint of fallopian tube, where it is fertilized by sperm. Next, implantation of fertilized egg into the endometrium of tube. You can observe the third point. Implantation of fertilized egg into the endometrium of uterus. Implantation is taking place at which layer of the uterus? That is endometrium. So first one is release of egg from ovary. Second one is egg reaches midpoint of fallopian tube. Where it undergoes the fertilization with the sperm. Finally, implantation of the fertilized egg at the region of the endometrium of the uterus. Can observe. Here, there are two ovaries. Two ovaries are near to the pimbria parts of the fallopian tubes. Okay, the ligaments, ovarian ligaments and broad ligaments, make the position of the uterus. There is a ovarian blood vessels. You can observe the suspensory ligament of ovary, and you can observe the fallopian tube. You can observe the pundus of the uterus. You can observe the cervix of the uterus. In cervix, you can observe the cervical canal, and it also has internal orifice. You can observe the endometrium, myometrium, perimetrium, that are walls of uterus. You can observe the round ligament of uterus. You can observe the ampulla, and you can observe the isthmus and infundibulum and fimbriae, that are called uterine tube. That are the parts of the uterine tubes are ampulla, isthmus, infundibulum, fimbriae. Fimbriae can take the ovum or egg. Coming to ovaries, which are also called as female gonads. Ovaries are called as female gonads. The ovaries are usually pear colored, oblong, and about the size of walnut. So the ovaries are usually pear colored, oblong, and about the size of a walnut. They are attached to the uterus by ligaments. In addition to producing female sex hormones, that female sex hormones nothing but estrogen and progesterone. This ovaries also produce the male sex hormones. That means predominant hormones in females are estrogen and progesterone. Predominant sex hormones in case of males, testosterone. Means males also can secrete the estrogen and progesterone, but their levels are low when compared to testosterone. Females also can secrete the testosterone, but their levels are very low when compared to estrogen and progesterone. So predominant female sex hormones are estrogen and progesterone. Predominant male sex hormones are testosterone. So these ovaries also produces and releases the X. The developing egg cells, oocyte, are contained in fluid-filled cavities. So the developing egg cells, oocytes, are contained in case of fluid-filled cavities called as follicles. That follicles are called as ovarian follicles. At which site of the ovaries there is a developing of oocyte? Are developing of egg cells, nothing but ovarian follicles in the wall of the ovaries. That ovarian follicles are located on the wall of the ovaries. Each follicle contains one oocyte. Each ovarian follicle contains one oocyte. These can have the ovarian follicles. That ovarian follicles, okay, can consist of the one oocyte. Each follicle can consist of the one oocyte or developing egg. Structure of the ovaries. Ovaries can have the medulla and cortex. Medulla of the ovaries supporting the framework made of fibrous tissue has ovarian blood vessels, lymphatics, and nerves travels through it. So there is not that much of importance with the medulla of the ovaries. The support framework made of fibrous tissue has ovarian blood vessels, lymphatics, and nerves travels through it. Lymphatics and nerves travels through it. I mean to cortex, which have the major role. Cortex of the ovary, functioning part of the ovum. Functioning part of the ovum is cortex. Functioning part of the ovum is cortex. Contains, this cortex contains ovarian follicles in different stages. Ovarian follicles in different stages. So the cortex of the ovary contains ovarian follicles in different stages. Very important. Which part of the ovary can have the ovarian follicles? Cortex. Which part of the ovary can have the ovarian follicles? Nothing but cortex. Is a functioning part of the ovum, contains ovarian follicles in different stages. Coming to ovulation. Ovulation is the major process in case of ovaries. How many ovaries are there in case of females? Two ovaries. They are attaching to uterus. Coming to ovulation. Process of releasing of one mature ovum in each month into that ovary's fallopian tube. They release or simply process of releasing of one mature ovum each month into the ovary's fallopian tube. Hormones from pituitary cause ovaries to begin producing female sex hormones. So the female sex hormones are released by the stimulation of the pituitary gland. So pituitary gland can stimulate the release of the female sex hormones from ovaries. There are two functions of ovaries. One is the releasing of the mature ovum. Second one is the releasing of the female sex hormones by the stimulation of the pituitary gland. Ovum to mature. Ovum can live about 2 days in fallopian tube. If ovum undergoes fertilization with one sperm cell, okay, it is also called as simply fertilization or conception. One sperm will enter one ovum. That is called as fertilization or conception. Right? So these are the functions of the ovaries. That is ovulation. Coming to continuation. If the ovum is not fertilized, it does not attach the uterine lining or endometrium. You know, endometrium is the place where there is a implantation of the fertilized egg. If ovum is not fertilized, it does not attach to the uterine lining or endometrium. So, muscles of the uterus, where muscles are present, which layer of the uterus can have the muscles? Myometrium. Which layer of the uterus can have the muscles? Myometrium. So, muscles of the uterus contract. So, lining breaks down, that is cramps. Lining passes through the cervix into the vaginal orifice and out of the vagina opening. That is called as menstruation. If the ovum is not fertilized, it does not attach to the endometrium of the uterus. So, the muscles of the uterus contract. That lining will be break down. That is called as cramps. That lining passes through the cervix. Into the vagina. Through vaginal orifice, it goes to the outside. Adult male have testes. That is plural. Adult female have ovaries. This is called as plural. Adult male have the testes. Adult female have the ovaries. Testes produces sperm. Sperm can have the 23 chromosomes. That is maybe either 23X or 23Y. Okay. Can say ovaries produce the ovum. Ovum can have the either 23X. Another one also 23X. Okay. Always there is a fertilization of the one sperm with one ovum. If it X containing sperm is fertilized with X containing ovum, determination of sex is female. Both are X. If sperm is consists of 23 chromosomes of Y. If it is undergoes the fertilization with X, that is 23X containing ovum. There is a boy. There is a sex determination is boy. Okay. The zygote growth by mitosis. is billions of mitosis occurred in case of zygote that leads to ultimately development of the fetus, development of the baby. In case of adult female. In case of adult female. See, accessory glands in case of female reproductive system are mammary glands. Accessory glands in case of kingdom are mammary glands. So accessory glands in case of male reproductive system are seminal vesicles, prostate glands, seminal vesicles, prostate glands, and these Cowper's glands, also called as bulbourethral glands. Cowper's glands also called as bulbourethral glands. In case of female reproductive system, the accessory glands are mammary glands. So these mammary glands are sweat glands specialized for production of the milk. These are sweat glands specialized for the production of milk. So the milk producing secretory cells, the milk producing secretory cells form walls of bulb, form walls of the bulb shaped chambers called alveoli. So the milk producing secretory cells form walls of bulb shaped structures or bulb shaped chambers called alveoli. Form walls of bulb shaped chambers called alveoli. That alveoli join together with the ducts in grape like fashion, in grape like fashion to form clusters called lobules. That forms the lobules. There are numerous lobules assembled to form a lobe. Lobules form the lobe. Each breast contains a single mammary gland consists of 150 to 20 of these lobules. So each breast consists of single mammary gland, consists of 15 to 20 of these lobes. Lobes are formed by clusters of lobules. Lobules form from the bulb shaped chambers called alveoli. Alveoli joined together forms the lobules. Lobules joined together forms the lobes. Okay. So in each mammary gland, there are about 15 to 20 of the lobules. 15 to 20 of the lobes. Each mammary gland have the 15 to 20 of the lobes. These lobes are formed by joining of the lobules. Lobules are formed from the joining of the alveoli. Alveoli are formed from the cells of the milk producing. Cells of the milk producing. Coming to lactiferous ducts. Lactiferous ducts leading away from the lobes. Leading away from the lobes widen into lactiferous sinuses that serves as a temporary reservoir for milk. So temporary reservoir for milk. Okay, that is lactiferous sinuses. Lactiferous sinuses that serves as a temporary reservoir for milk. So temporary reservoir for urine, urinary bladder. Urinary bladder. Reservoir for sperm, epididymis. Epididymis. Getting? So, temporary reservoir for milk, lactiferous sinuses. Lactiferous sinuses. So, lactiferous sinuses that serve as a temporary reservoir for milk. If the ovum is not fertilized, already I told you, it does not attach to the uterine lining. Already I told you, yes, it is over. Coming to normal menstrual cycle, from this, they asked the question in previous JPAT. So, normal menstrual cycle, mean duration of the menstrual cycle is 28 days. Okay, if only 15% of range is 21 to 30, only 15% of females have their menstrual cycle between 21 to 35. 21 to 35. So, mean duration of the menstrual cycle is 28 days. Average duration of menses, once menses will come, it will take place from 3 to 8 days. Normal estimated blood loss through menstruation approximately 30 ml in every month. So normal estimated blood loss is approximately 30 ml. Coming to ovulation, ovulation occur usually at day 14th of the menstruation. 36 hours after the onset of mid-cycle, that is luteinizing hormone surge. So ovulation occur usually at day of 14. Coming to normal menstrual cycle continuation, the phases of the menstrual cycle and ovulation regulates by, very important, the phases of the menstrual cycle and ovulation regulates by interaction between the hypothalamus, pituitary and ovaries. Ovaries secretes the hormones, that hormone is nothing but progesterone and estrogen by the stimulation of the pituitary. Pituitary function is controlling by the hypothalamus. So the phases of the menstrual cycle and ovulation regulates by interaction between the hypothalamus, pituitary and ovaries. Mean age of menarche. Menarche means that is production capacity of the ovum. Production capacity of the ovum, especially in case of puberty. So mean age of menarche and menopause are menarche is 12.7 years. Mean age of menarche 12.7 years. And menopause is at the age of the 51.4 years. So at age of 51, normally they get the menopause. That puberty will start at 12.7 years. So mean age of menarche is 12.7 years. So puberty age is 12.7 years. Means simply I can say 12 years. Menopause at 51 years. Coming to cycle, it is strongly linked to the endocrine system. Already I told, hormone based and paracrine based. Typically it takes 28 days to cycle through 4 phases. In 28 days it undergoes the 4 phases. That 4 phases are follicular phase, ovulation phase, luteal phase, menstruation. Luteal phase and menstruation. Follicular phase, ovulation phase, luteal phase, menstrual phase. Next one is hormones rise and fall. What are the hormones rises and fall during this menstrual cycle? So menstrual cycle consists of 4 phases. First follicle, ovarian follicles. Each ovarian follicle can secrete one ovum. One follicle with equal to one ovum. It leads to the formation of the ovum. So formation of ovum is called as ovulation. Okay, that leads to the action of the hormones, that is luteal phase. If fertilization not occurred, there is occurring of the menstruation. That is the, in case of ovulation, you see hormones in the blood in case of follicular phase, okay, and in case of luteal phase. Major, there are 2 phases, follicular phase, ovulation followed by luteal. So ovulation is depending upon the follicular. The follicles will depend in presence in case of ovaries. Follicles presence in case of ovaries. You can see hormone levels. That is the ovulation, follicular phase, ovulation phase, luteal phase. Finally, there is a menstrual phase. In follicular phase, there is a more levels of the follicle stimulating hormone. And also estrogen. And majorly there is a luteinizing hormone. So abundant levels of the luteinizing hormone, okay, and also estrogen followed by the follicle stimulating hormone. You can observe in case of luteal phase, in luteal phase the major hormone is progesterone. In luteal phase the major hormone is progesterone. Progesterone levels are very low in case of follicular phase. In follicular phase, the major hormone is luteinizing hormone followed by estrogen. Right? So, estrogen and luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone more in case of follicular phase. Whereas in case of luteal phase, the major hormone is progesterone. The progesterone levels are very low in case of follicular phase. Coming to first phase, follicular phase begins when estrogen levels are low. So, at starting stage, the estrogen levels are low. Anterior pituitary secretes follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Stimulate the follicle to develop. Very important. Anterior pituitary secretes follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. They stimulate the follicle to develop the ovum. So cells around egg enlarge, releasing the estrogen. So estrogen is released by the cells which are surrounding the ovaries, and which cells which are surrounding the ovum. Cells around egg enlarge and releases the estrogen. The ovum itself releases the estrogen. This causes the uterine lining to thicken. So this estrogen helpful in the thickening of the uterine walls. Very important. So begins when estrogen levels are low. that anterior pituitary secretes follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone stimulate follicle to develop. Once follicle will develop around the cells of the follicle or around the cells of the egg, enlarge and releases the estrogen. This causes the uterine lining to thicken. This hormone causes the uterine lining to thicken. Coming to next part is ovulation. So that luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone both still being released. The releasing of the luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone is going for another 3 to 4 days. So both luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone being released continuously for another 3 to 4 days. Follicles ruptures, releases the ova into the fallopian tubes. So releasing of the ova into the fallopian tubes by the rupturing of the follicle. Follicle ruptures and releases the ova into the fallopian tubes. Which part of the fallopian tubes can catch the ovum? Fimbria, the last part of the uterus or the last part of the fallopian tubes are fimbria. These are finger-like projections. So follicle ruptures releases the ova into the fallopian tubes. Coming to next, luteal phase. In luteal phase, now empty follicle. Why? Because the follicle releases the ovum into the fallopian tube. Now the follicle will be the empty. So now empty follicle changes to a yellow. By rupturing, released the ova, that empty follicle changes to a yellow color. That is called as corpus luteum. It continues to secrete the estrogen. The follicle can continue secretion of the estrogen, but now begins to release progesterone. Now there is a releasing of the progesterone. Progesterone plays the immense role in case of luteal phase. Progesterone further develops uterine lining. The progesterone also helpful in further development of the uterine lining. If pregnant, embryo will release hormones to preserve corpus luteum, that is human chorionic gonadotropin. Very, very important. So testing of pregnancy by measurement of which levels of hormone in female urine or in female pregnant female, that is human chorionic gonadotropin. Human chorionic gonadotropin released from the embryo of the female. So in female pregnancy test kit measures the levels of the human chorionic gonadotropin present in urine of the pregnant woman. This is the question came in previous GPAT. So the progesterone further develops uterine lining. If pregnant, embryo will release hormones to preserve corpus luteum. So if pregnant, embryo will release the hormones to preserve the corpus luteum. Coming to menstruation, if no embryo, the corpus luteum begins to disintegrate. In case of menstruation, if no embryo, there is no development of the embryo, the corpus luteum begins to disintegrate. Why? Because there is no embryo, there is no purpose of the corpus luteum. The corpus luteum begins to disintegrate. Progesterone levels drop. Here, no, there is no requirement of progesterone. Progesterone levels drop. Uterine lining detaches. Menstruation can begin. So, tissue, blood, unfertilized egg all discharged through menstruation. It can take from 3 to 7 days. Already I told this menstruation. If no embryo, the corpus luteum begins to disintegrate. Progesterone levels drop. Uterine lining detaches. Menstruation can begin. So menstrual fluid can have the tissue and blood and unfertilized egg that all will be discharged through menstruation. So this is the menstrual cycle in females. which can take 28 days. It has the four phases. Four phases are, first phase is follicular phase. Second phase is ovulation. Third phase is luteal phase. Fourth phase is menstrual phase. Fourth phase is menstrual phase. So in case of follicular phase, so this menstrual cycle is regulating by the hormones, regulating by the hormones. In case of follicular phase, there is a development of the ovum. That means formation of the ovum. That means there is a process of the follicles, process of the follicles. That is called as follicular phase. In follicular phase, the hormones place are luteinizing hormone, estrogen, and follicle stimulating hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone. They can stimulate the ovarian follicles to form the ovum, to form the ovum. Next, in case of ovulation, releasing of the egg or releasing of the ovum into the last part of the fallopian tube, that is fimbriae, that is fimbriae, right? So this phase is called as ovulation. Okay, once it releases the ovum into the fimbriae, that is called as empty follicle. So next, coming to the luteal phase. In luteal phase, the major hormone is progesterone. So before luteal phase, the estrogen, follicle stimulating hormone, right, and also luteinizing hormone, both involved in lining of the uterus. Whereas in case of luteal phase, only progesterone. In luteal phase, only progesterone involved in lining of the uterus. You can see the phases, development of the follicles. You can take first part. This is the ovary. The structure is ovary, primary follicle. The primary follicle converted into the growing follicle. So you can see the size. Primary follicle can have the less size. That will be grown, converting into the growing follicle. Now it has the egg cell and follicular cells. Egg cell and follicular cells. You can see how that egg cell will be converted. See, you can take follicular fluid and mature follicle. This is called as mature follicle. Third stage is mature follicle. That mature follicle have the protective cells, and inside it has the egg. That is the releasing of the ovum. So that is called as ovulation. Release of the ovum into the fimbria of the fallopian tubes. Once it releases the its ovum, or but that is matured egg, right? This matured egg released into the fallopian tube. Next, that is called as empty follicle. Why? Because it releases the empty follicle. That empty follicle converted into the corpus luteum. How that corpus luteum is regressing of the corpus luteum. That will be discharged in case of menstruation. For first stage is follicular phase. In follicular phase, there is development of the ovum in case of follicular phase. In ovulation, there is release of the ovum into the fallopian tube. Once it releases the ovum into the fallopian tube, that will be the empty follicle. That empty follicle converting into the corpus luteum. That is, corpus luteum is undergoes the regresses or disintegration and undergoes the discharging through menstrual fluid along with blood. So that is the primary follicle, growing follicle, follicular cells, in between or center egg cell. That is the mature follicle. That is the release of the ovum into the fallopian tube, empty follicle, corpus luteum regresses. Yes, this is the significant role of the ovaries in the releasing of the ovum and the phases. In which phase progesterone levels are more? Nothing but luteal phase. In which phase there is a releasing of the ovum will takes place? Ovulation. In which phase there is a development of the ovarian follicles will takes place? That is follicular phase. Okay. once you can I make the review. So place of the implantation of embryo uterus is endometrium. Place of the development of placenta is endometrium. Place of the fertilization is fallopian tubes. Release of the ovum into the which place of the fallopian tube? Embryo. Right? At the same time, how that fetus will develop into the from embryo by undergoing the millions of the cell divisions. The embryo can be converted into the fetus. So this is the end of the presentation of the female reproductive system and male reproductive system. Male reproductive system produces the sperm. Female reproduction system produces the ovum. Both undergoes the fertilization and finally develops the zygote. This zygote, upon several million divisions of cell divisions ultimately leads to the development of the fetus. So by this, I am ending my presentation. So all of you, once again, good luck. And you can utilize these days for a preparation of the GPAT. If you have any queries, you can post. I can solve your queries. To my knowledge, I explained you related to the anatomy and physiology part 1. I gave you basics. These basics may be helpful for your future in case of understanding of the further subjects and maybe writing of any competitive examination. Okay. Thank you one and all for all organizers and also learners who watch my presentation. Okay, thank you one and all. Thank you.